The state of the planet is it's trying to support too many human beings. The planet is in good shape. If Homo sapiens went extinct, the planet would not suffer at all. But the capacity of the planet to support human beings involves how much biodiversity it has, because we're part of biodiversity and we're utterly dependent on biodiversity.
My name is Nastaran. I was born and raised in Iran, where I spent the first part of my life immersed in its snowy mountain landscapes and obsessed with its beautiful and sometimes mysterious wildlife. I now live in England, where I own a home, run my own business, and live a relatively normal life. Having recently seen some devastating statistics on global wildlife habitat destruction and noticing animals suffering images online, I want to look into what having a relatively normal life in a developed country means in terms of wildlife habitat loss around the globe, and ask myself a very challenging question. As a citizen of a developed nation, what can I really do to minimize animal suffering and habitat loss worldwide?
We have lost half of the populations of other organisms that are important to us on the planet in the last 40 or 50 years.
Any action that involves large-scale mining for raw metals or fossil fuels, such as driving an electric car or running a combustion engine, will be an easy target, as would eating industrial meat or fish. But I want to look at something often overlooked and even harder to avoid: normal everyday food. So I'm going to start with the supermarket. This is my typical weekly shopping. It is not a large shop, and I wasn't thinking about anything particular while I was cruising around the aisles, other than my meals and snacks for the next few days. Taking some time to read the labels, I'm drawn to this pack of green beans. As it is green bean season in the UK at the moment, this was the only brand available, and they look to be from Kenya. I was a little confused by this, so I've just done a quick search, and it appears that the UK can only grow food for 21 million people, and there are 66 million of us living here. So the majority of our food is grown in other parts of the world, using other people's land and water. So now I'm wondering if even buying a simple pack of green beans can potentially be a cause of habitat loss and animal suffering. I never wanted to have any children, and one of the reasons is that there are far too many people on the planet. Could my decision help the wildlife? After a fairly lengthy session spent on the internet looking for information on this, there was nothing solid to be found. So I'm going to honor my original question, go all in, and head to Kenya to see for myself how my own eating habits could be potentially harming the very thing I desperately want to protect. After a long drive across the most beautiful landscape I've ever seen, I now arrive at the place I come to see with my own eyes. This place grows my green beans. It also grows flowers, fruits, and other vegetables, all destined for the European market. Although it looks ugly and pumps millions of liters of water from a local lake, this place does provide a huge amount of employment for the local region and contributes to national economic growth and stability. This is what I fear the most, though. It seems there is a direct relationship between global economic growth and wildlife habitat loss. So I went to visit Mara Predator Conservation Program, find out more about this and other potential threats they are seeing on a daily basis.
The biggest challenge we have, I would say, in the general marine landscape is the fact that we are losing a lot of land because of change of land use. So each family wanting to fence off their land to keep their livestock in their own private land. And that has created a big negative impact to wildlife because all the major migratory corridors, like, for example, between Masai Mara and Loita Plains, which is east of Masai Mara, has completely become cut off because of fences. And one other major corridor, which was mainly an elephant and, I would say, predator corridor to Loita Forest, has also been blocked. So you would find that free movement of wildlife between one habitat to another has been cut off. And that has a very negative impact on I would say, reproduction, gene pools, for example, and then that creation of that free space. I would say because of the increasing human population, land is reducing. So population increases, wildlife numbers increase, livestock numbers increase, but the amount of land is finite. It cannot increase. So we all compete for that space.
So my job is really to encourage people to understand why we need to have predators now and into the future. Because one of the things we found out is that communities really don't understand that the numbers of predators are really going down. And also how to create coexistence, because that is very important. We do this through human-wildlife conflict mitigation strategies. In the Mara now, some areas which are being fenced, and a lot of fencing is coming up, which obviously takes away space available for carnivores or other wildlife to roam. Sometimes people use poison to kill predators, and that not only affects the target predator, but also any other predator that comes and feeds on that carcass. There is some various factors that are bringing about conflict. So one of it is habitat shrinkage, because now you know there is only limited land for all carnivores, herbivores, and livestock. So they have to try and share, but this close interaction now brings conflict.
Part of my work is involving in lion monitoring, and the reason why we do lion monitoring is to understand their trends and population over time. So we've had lions' space going down because of other activities such as human settlement coming in, blockage of wildlife corridors. We don't know where they go, so we monitor them to understand their ecology, to understand where do they go after they are sent out from their natural pride. So we've been following them, and to a surprise, these are the ones who get involved with the human wildlife conflict. The community here are livestock keepers. We've had the neighbors or the communities going after lions, and we've had lions also going after the community or after people and livestock. So we are trying to create that partnership, bringing together. We've seen people gaining benefits. We've seen people seeing wildlife as important and not as a threat.
It seems there are a multitude of factors threatening wild animals on a daily basis. But one threat I found particularly interesting was the growing human population. Because it isn't just unique to Kenya, it is happening all over the world. and is the reason why places like the UK are now fully dependent on other countries' natural resources for their food. So I headed back to the UK to chat with some population experts to hopefully shine a light on the seemingly taboo subject of global overpopulation.
Of their resources, particularly in things like embedded water in products, whether they be green.
Death, if you care about not dying of thirst, biodiversity stands between us in one way or another to all of those fates.
We are buying.
Solar panels is going to solve that. We're dooming billions of people to a brutal fate.
There was a very good study by Lund University back in 2017, and they wanted to look at all the positive things an individual could do to take the heat of our planet.
Fronts that we're facing.
The curve of population growth is replicated by the increase of tropical forest loss, the increase of fertilizer use, which adds to greenhouse gases, the increase of over-extraction of marine fisheries.
Working towards a smaller population is something that is extremely critical and important.
For us, choosing smaller families is a major benefit, and it's many times more impactful than some of the other good eco actions we can take.
There will be a time when overshoot cannot be denied. I hope that time is not when things are collapsing.
We are in overshoot. We are way beyond the level that the planet can continue to support.
Just agriculture alone takes more than 50% of all of the habitable land on the planet.
When numbers seem to be going down, in terms of the total fertility rate, because there's a greater number of people overall, there is still growth.
The environmental movement as a whole have to keep in mind that the size of the human population is a critical. And to ignore it is insane.
Having seen for myself, studied satellite and other online imagery, and spoken to professionals and scientists all over the world. There is absolutely no doubt that there are far too many humans on this planet. As someone who truly values the fact we still have some pristine wildlife habitat left, it is clear that the best thing I can do by a long way is to make a choice not to have children.